Penguin Random House Audio presents: First, wear a face mask, a doctor's guide to reducing risk of infection during the pandemic and beyond, by Dr. Philip M. Tierno, Jr., read for you by Jim Seybert. Note to listeners: no book can replace the diagnostic expertise and medical advice of a trusted physician. Please be certain to consult with your doctor before making any decisions that affect your health, particularly if you suffer from any medical condition or have any symptom that may require treatment. To all the brave healthcare workers, first responders, scientists, members of the military, and a myriad of others, especially service workers who chose to work through the COVID-19 pandemic, many of whom paid the ultimate price, they sacrificed themselves and rose to the challenge, exceeding all expectations for the benefit of their fellow man. Introduction: An Ounce of Prevention. For the moment, let's take a step backward in order to fully assess what happened to us as individuals, as citizens, and as members of the global community during the spread of COVID-19. Simply put, the lives of every member of our human civilization on planet Earth were completely disrupted and changed by the lowest life form on Earth, an invisible germ. The sheer enormity of that is a stark realization. A pandemic caused by a virus literally closed down America as well as the rest of the world. Nothing can better exemplify the interconnectedness of man and microbes than the COVID-19 pandemic. We humans are only part of the web of life on Earth, and our well-being depends upon an intimate cooperation with the lowly germ. Even though the science of microbiology is little more than a century old, we have learned a lot about germs. We must use that body of knowledge to prevent catastrophic disruptions on Earth like the one caused by the COVID-19 virus. To do that requires all of us, scientific and medical personnel, as well as the public, to understand the dynamics at play so that we all follow the known basic protocols for fighting an infection, or for that matter, a pandemic. While the story of the novel coronavirus COVID-19 is still unfolding as I'm writing this book, it is important to recognize that in a global economy of mass migration and frequent travel, there is no such thing as an isolated population group. And there is certainly no guarantee that a disease outbreak in that population won't go global in a couple of days. From a public health perspective, the world's population is one big family. An outbreak in China concerns people in London, LA, and New York City. Our past history indicates that it is easy to predict that infectious diseases, both old and new, will continue to emerge and challenge the world's established medical and scientific infrastructures from time to time. In order to meet that challenge, we must educate all countries and their people about ways to prevent infection. Doing so would do more to enhance health, at a lower cost, than would any form of treatment. The new novel coronavirus has re-emphasized the need for every person to understand the basic dynamics of infectious disease, to learn how we make each other sick, and what we can do to protect our loved ones as well as ourselves. This book will help you learn how we make each other sick and how to increase your chances of evading infection, which not only has obvious benefits to your personal well-being, but also breaks the chain of infection transmission. The COVID-19 virus had an unprecedented impact on the world. It caused a pandemic involving more than 200 countries and territories, complete with a worldwide economic disaster, financial collapse, and adverse psychological manifestations for the masses. There clearly is a need to present information in a concise, straightforward, and non-hyperbolic manner on how we can understand and then mitigate any such infections in the future. There is, unfortunately, a proliferation of false, contradictory, or simply overwhelming information on the internet. Figuring out how to stay safe in this changed world by watching the news, searching on websites and social media, or listening to your friends, can feel like drinking from a fire hose. As a microbiologist with 40-plus years' experience, I've set out to share the most important information about how infections spread and how you can stay safe from all manner of contagious diseases in a digestible, approachable, and even reassuring manner. If you want to get straight to the strategies, skip ahead to part two. I'll walk you through the most common scenarios you'll encounter in everyday life: commuting, traveling, cooking, and keeping your house, kids, and pets safe. But after you've grounded yourself in these important life skills, I encourage you to flip back to part one and learn the larger context of how infections spread through populations. This will help you sift through what you hear on the news and from health authorities so that you can take your health into your own hands. With this book, you can feel assured in arming yourself both against false information with a basic understanding of infectious diseases and against infection itself with best practices. As the old adage advises, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Part 1. Everything you need to know about germs. Chapter 1. What's a coronavirus? You probably picked up this book because you're worried about COVID-19, so let's start there. Coronaviruses are a worldwide group of RNA viruses, ribonucleic acid, the genetic material of some viruses, that were first identified in the 1960s. Bacterial and human cells have both RNA and DNA, but viruses have either one but not both, because they are more primitive cell types. They are the cause of about 15-30% of common colds, usually in the winter months. The primary symptoms produced are similar to another cold virus, rhinoviruses, which cause about 50% of common colds, and both are typified by an upper respiratory infection with a stuffy nose, loss of smell and taste are common, coughing, usually dry, varying fever, malaise, and fatigue. Some adults carry the virus without fever, and most of these ordinary strains are treated with over-the-counter medications for the symptoms that they cause. The infection rarely spreads to the lower respiratory tract to cause pneumonia. That's more likely to occur in people who are older or who have comorbidities like COPD, heart disease, diabetes, or are immunosuppressed. Studies have shown that antibodies to the coronavirus appear in childhood and increase with age. It has also been shown that people can be reinfected in some cases after a period of about a year. That's why respiratory viruses continually cause colds in humans, although immunity usually lasts longer and maybe even for life. Coronaviruses are also suspected of causing gastroenteritis, with the virus sometimes found in the stool. Animals also have infections caused by coronaviruses, but their viruses usually do not infect humans, and vice versa, human strains don't usually infect animals. Sometimes, however, they do. An outbreak of a novel coronavirus that jumped from animals to humans called SARS, Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome, occurred in South China in late 2002, and by the time it waned in mid-2003, resulted in 8,000 cases in 29 countries, with more than 800 deaths, a case fatality rate of 10%. Clearly, we learned in that outbreak that animal coronaviruses can mutate and jump from animal species to humans. In fact, a perfect evolutionary melting pot occurred in the Chinese open-air animal market, where people commingled with animals daily. These animals were slaughtered on the spot and then packaged and sold to people who use them in ritual ceremonies or for food delicacies. Coronaviruses have the ability to exhibit a high frequency of mutation and an especially high incidence of deletion mutations. They also undergo a high frequency of recombination during replication. This becomes a perfect prerequisite for a mutation that allows jumping species from animals to humans. It is believed that the SARS virus, for example, jumped from a bat to a civet cat to humans. In 2012, there was another coronavirus outbreak called MERS, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome. According to the CDC, Health officials first reported the disease in Saudi Arabia in September 2012, but later identified that the actual first MERS case occurred in Jordan in April 2012. It then spread from the Middle East to Africa, Asia, and Europe. In May 2015, there was an outbreak of MERS in Korea.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.